Good morning. If you're in the sanctuary, welcome back. We are delighted to have you. I'm coming up with new theories of ministry since people are so happy and excited about being back after having been forced outside for a while. We're going to start taking other things away from you for a while and then waves of delight year after year. Seriously, it is great to have you with us. If you're watching us on Facebook, thank you for being faithful and for being with us. If you're present in the sanctuary, will you rise? And we're going to pray our way back into this beautiful facility. Let's have an attitude of prayer. Father, we give thanks to you for your grace always, for the gift of fellowship that you've created through the church. And today, we are mindful and give thanks to you for ceilings and roofs and buildings and the ability to be inside with one another without the elements being difficult for us. We thank you for the faithfulness that folks have displayed throughout the COVID season. And we do ask a blessing on those who are struggling with that disease and who live daily in fear of it. We ask for healing and for grace. We are delighted to worship you here in this place, and our pledge to you this day and moving forward is that we will share your good news in the way that we live and in the things that we say. It's in Christ's holy name that we pray. Amen. So we're still going to have recorded music because the rules are in flux about whether or not you can sing. We're going to listen to the songs and watch them on the screens. I think we have words to go with them. And you might know if you were attending church before COVID started that my big dream was that when we returned, the doggone screens would work. So we're going to find out if you'll have an attitude of worship.
Rain down, all around the world we're singing. Rain down, can you hear the God, shut the heavens. Do not shut. Do not shut. Do not shut the heavens. But open up our hearts, God. But open up. Open up. Open up our hearts. Rain down all around the world. We're singing. Rain down. Give me strength.
Amen. Please be seated. So this is our third and final sermon on addictions, and I've chosen for the scripture Matthew 28, 16 through 20. I'll give you a heads up on that. This scripture is reflected in step 12 of the 12 steps, which we'll read in just a moment. Matthew 28, 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." May the Lord add blessing to the reading of Scripture. The 12 steps in full. Remember, as we list these, that they are not just the 12 steps to sobriety, they also outline the path of faith for most people. Step one, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol and that our lives had become unmanageable. Step two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Step three, we made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood Him. Step four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Step five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Step six, we were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Step seven, we humbly ask God to remove our shortcomings. Eight, we made a list of all persons we had harmed and we became willing to make amends to them all. Step nine, we made direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. Step 10, we continued to take a personal inventory, and when we were wrong, we promptly admitted it. Step 11, we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood Him, praying only for the knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that will out. And step 12, Having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Those are the 12 steps. So before I dive into the points in the sermon this morning, I want to confess to you that as a young man in college, I took every course that I could on addictions and alcoholism, not because it was present in my primary family. My mother was actually a teetotaler, but because it was so prevalent in the arena that I grew up in outside of my house, including my mother's boyfriends. Almost all of them, I now realize, were hopeless alcoholics. And alcoholism and drug addiction was rampant in Casper in those days. As far as I know, it still is. A lot of reasons for that. But I grew up in a culture where, as I came to maturity, I began to understand you can't trust all adults, because a lot of adults are literally out of their mind and they're living in a reality that I don't understand. So part of my quest for understanding not only my own life, but really the nature and the power of God and how to navigate in a way that was in keeping with Christ's teachings led me to study these things. Over the years, I have been to many AA meetings. I'm always welcomed as clergy, and many of my best friends in life are longtime recovering alcoholics, which makes sense since it's been such an interest to me, and since I discovered in my studies that the 12 steps really are a fundamental outline of the Christian faith and the walk that we take with Jesus. Now, today we're going to talk about some very difficult things, because we're not really going to talk very much about the alcoholic or the addict. We're going to talk about the enabler. We're going to talk about people who live in the sphere of influence of those with addiction problems. And I'm going to point out some things that are commonly done or thought or assumed on behalf of people who are in relationship with alcoholics and addicts that are to the detriment of the addict. That doesn't mean that I am pointing fingers or being harsh in my judgment. It's just a matter of the fact that a lot of times one of the hardest parts of sobriety is overcoming the many obstacles that well-intentioned people in the lives of the addict and alcoholic throw up and put in their way. So some of what's said today might sting a little bit, but please be assured it's not meant to be a rebuke or a harsh judgment. We deal as much as we can just with the truth in this church, and I hope that all of us will be better for having gone through some of these ways that we enable and some of the things that we do that are really, if you understand what you're dealing with, really unhealthy behavior patterns to help the addict or the alcoholic. So I've got a list here because I'm a Methodist and we love lists. Some things I think we all should know. Number one, addictions and alcoholism are very difficult to diagnose. When I say that, you might think, no, it isn't, right? 3 drunk driving tickets, time in jail, lost the job, lost the family. That's not difficult at all. Nope, not for you. But for the person who is spiraling in addiction, it's very, very hard. And here is the reason. You can have 2 people, same age, same background, same pretty much socioeconomic standing, who both drink heavily every night and all weekend long. Let's say they're in their 30s, and you might think, wow, they're both on the road to alcoholism, and all the evidence points that way, when the truth is that one of those people will, in fact, eventually identify themselves as an alcoholic after a long and torturous road, and the other person never will, and not only that, they will not be an alcoholic. Because even though everything else is exactly the same, they will find that they are perfectly capable of stopping the addictive behavior when they have to, and they do, and they're genuinely not an alcoholic. In those same 2 people, if you track them 10 years down the road, let's say that the alcoholic has sobered up and is on the road to sobriety, at that 10-year mark, if they drink, they're dead in the water. They'll be as drunk as they ever were as soon as they possibly can. The other person, they can drink. And they can drink with no problem. And they can drink without destroying their lives or whatever. So one of the things that happens is we look at the behavior pattern of somebody and we say, wow, that's obviously a problem, right? And because we're helpful, we go to point it out to them, right? You appear to me to have an addiction problem, or you're an alcoholic, right? Whether you admit it to yourself or not. It's a very, very difficult thing. The fundamental rule that I have learned is you're an alcoholic when you realize you're an alcoholic, and not until. You're not an alcoholic because everybody around you tells you that you are, and it isn't even particularly helpful to be telling people that they are. So we should admit at the outset that when it comes to addictions, that there is a chemical and a biological part of it that you can't see, so that it is truly possible for people to behave in the same self-destructive way and one of them be able to recover easily, at will, and the other one to be hopelessly addicted and in a lifestyle that just absolutely drives out of control. If you are not the person who's drinking or drugging, then you don't know if they're an alcoholic or an addict. It's a weird thing, but it has to be a self-diagnosis if there's ever going to be healing. That makes it exceptionally hard, doesn't it? It's very difficult to know. You don't actually get to call somebody an alcoholic or an addict. You can note all the behavior patterns match up, but no one knows really except for them, and they won't know until they, in the words of Scripture, come to themselves on a place where they're out of all the rest of hope. So it's very, very difficult. It's a hard thing. If you've ever talked to someone who you thought was an alcoholic or an addict, and your intent was to convince them that they were, then you already know what the argument is, right? I can stop anytime I want, and I don't have a problem. You have a problem, and your problem is you're running around judging other people while you got problems of your own. Have you ever had that conversation? I have enough times that I finally learned to quit having that conversation. Okay, so they're complex. The diagnosis, very, very difficult, very hard. In addition, there are different types of addiction and alcoholism, and they have different statistical rates of sobriety. The hardest type of alcoholism for a person to confront and gain sobriety from is called binge alcoholism. And that is an alcoholic who will drink themselves literally into a stupor until they pass out. And many times in their lives, they'll probably be in an ER being taken care of. But when they come out of those episodes, they're perfectly capable of stopping drinking for long periods of time with no intervention, without AA, without anything else. And so in their self-conversation, even though everybody says you got to quit drinking because it's leading to bad ends, they know, and it's a fact, that they can stop for long periods of time any time they want to. The trouble is that when they take the first drink after however long, they're right back where they started from, right? And so it becomes an almost impossible dynamic for a person to convince themselves they really have a problem when the actual truth of their life is they have a problem and they do get passed out drunk a lot, but they can also stop anytime they want without intervention. That person is likely to continue to exhibit that form of alcoholism all of their life without ever having a self-recognition. Binge alcoholism is one of the toughest ones to deal with and one of the toughest ones to heal. I once had a conversation with a young woman whose fiance was a binge alcoholic. And the conversation took place after he had gone roaring drunk and tried to start a fist fight at a wedding. And my advice to her when she described, he hasn't done this for 2 years now, and he doesn't do it all the time, and he won't drink again for a very long time. I talked to her about binge alcoholism and told her that the time to get out is now, honey, right? Because you're young and you're smart, but you're going to lose that youth, and this thing's going to go on forever and ever. It's not likely statistically to stop. She did not take the advice, and I don't blame her, right? It's pretty harsh advice, but now we're in a period of time where he's in prison from his last episode, and he was sober for several years, right? But when he drank again, he went right down the tubes, ended up in getting arrested for drunk driving. The alcohol limit was so high, that they shipped him off to jail. And likely, they will both think to themselves, he's finished now, right? And he'll go sober again for a few years. Who knows what hell will break loose the next time? Very difficult form of alcoholism. The statistical sobriety rate for long-term sobriety, almost nil. for other types or manifestations of addictions and alcoholism, and I'll repeat this later again because I really want you to know it, 10 to 12% of those who identify as addicts or alcoholics, 10 to 12% are able to maintain sobriety for 5 years or more. Reverse that, 90% of people who self-identify, who come to full well know, I have a problem, will never be able to gain long-term sobriety. Now, what that tells us, if we pay close attention, is it's a deadly and horrifying disease. It doesn't tell you anything about the worth or the values or the caring of the person who is an addict or an alcoholic. It just tells you what a high mountain it is to climb. Very, very hard. If you know an addict or an alcoholic, self-identified, who has been sober for really 3 years or more, you are literally looking at a person who is a walking miracle and a testament to the power of a spiritual path and to the power of opening your heart in humility to the power of God and asking God to come in and work. Okay, so alcoholism is complex. Addiction and alcoholism are deadly. And when people succumb to those things, even though they very frequently act in horrifying ways in order to maintain the addiction, you're not learning anything about the core person. What you are seeing are the inevitable effects of an addiction. When an addict or an alcoholic wakes up in the morning, every morning, when the addiction is active, here is what they think and how they conceive of the world. I got to get high, and I have a plan to do that, and that plan will include my family or my coworkers or my friends, unless they're an impediment to me, in which case I'm cutting them out of my life because my only plan is to get high to make the pain stop. People who don't think that way, who aren't addicts, when they hear that and try to process it, think that's insane. No one thinks that every day. It is the singular goal of the addict or the alcoholic to get high, period. Every day, every time you talk with them, while you're having a pleasant conversation, if they're not high at that time, they are at that time plotting how to get high, and you will either help or hinder them. It's a worldview that is almost impossible to take in. But as I say these things, I know that almost everybody has somebody they love who is an addict, and your experience will verify this. The most common response when somebody in the family is an alcoholic or an addict is disbelief that they would continue to drink or to drug, even though all the horrible things that accompany addictions keep going on. And not only that, but when any sane person would say, enough is enough, I got to do something, they double down, and if it's possible, they do even worse things, including stealing from their family, lying to their best friends, doing horrendous things to the people around them who want to help them. It's because, in a word, they're very good alcoholics or addicts. If you're going to be a good alcoholic, what do you have to do? Set everything else aside in order to get drunk. If you're dealing with somebody who is an alcoholic, you got to know that doesn't change until they're sober and sober for a while. Their goal in life is distinctly different than everybody else's. Most of us want peace. We want to get along. We'd like to have some fun. We'd like to have some plans that we work towards. All those are really great things for human beings to do. You must understand, please memorize this. That is not the worldview or the goal set for people who are dealing with addictions. It's a radically different, delusional version of reality. And when you learn that, then it helps you be less of an enabler. Okay, so now, addictions grow and develop over time. People in AA meetings very frequently report that they knew right at the first time they had whiskey. Only what they know is, wow, I have finally found the answer to all the things that I feel inside. Because when I had the first shot of whiskey or the first illicit beer out of the fridge when mom and dad were out dancing or whatever, right? When I had the first introduction of the substance to my body, everything became crystal clear for me. This is the answer. I feel great, and I've never felt this way before. That's addictive thinking. But they're not an addict necessarily right away, and they don't go into full-blown addiction when they're 12 and have their first drink. They build up to it, right? They socially drink when it's possible. They illicitly drink every chance they get, and they're surrounded by a culture and people who push alcohol and drugs now as if they're nothing more than candy, and so they are perfectly normal while the addiction sinks in and takes complete control of their lives. 10, 15, 20 years before it really manifests, right? When people get out of their 20s and they start to sober up and get on with their life, it's the alcoholic or the addict who begins to lag behind seriously, who want to continue to party because when they were normal, they never had to face any kind of questions. It's a progressive disease. And it progresses at least in part because we've so normalized being out of your mind drunk or high that no one can tell the difference when you're in your 20s. No one can tell the difference. So, how do we do what we can? One of the primary things, and it's a source of contention in the addictive community and in the sober community. So let's say that you have somebody in your family or your friendship ties, and they go to rehab, and then they begin to work the 12 steps, and they've admitted, I have a problem. I have a problem with alcohol. And they're going to come over to your house for dinner. And you know that they are an alcoholic, self-diagnosed, and you know their history. Got it? And you say, we're serving wine anyway, right? Because I've had enough of Johnny. All he's ever done is mess things up and ruin my life. And if he can't drink, that's his problem. I have a right at my dinner party to serve what I want to serve. You do. That's absolutely true. And if Johnny doesn't like it, he can go somewhere else, or he's going to have to learn to be sober in a world awash with alcohol anyway, so he may as well start now. But when we say that on a Sunday morning in the clear light of day and we're not deluding ourselves, can you hear how crass that is? It is the assertion of your personal rights over Christ's demand that you live graciously. Because a gracious person would never put a substance on a table in front of a person in the midst of a life and death struggle and say to them, damn you, I'll drink if I want to. I don't have a problem. You do. No one who knows these things and conceives of how deadly the addictive process is, would ever choose to drink or drug in front of somebody who they know full well is fighting a battle which will result very often in a horrifying death. Because your right to consume those substances or keep them in your house, it's absolute. Nobody would argue that. I wouldn't argue it. You do have a right to do what you want. But I would plead to have the good sense to be gracious to somebody who's in one of the most horrifying battles where the odds are stacked against them that they can possibly be and who needs a safe place. If you're an alcoholic, you've spent years thinking about how to get your next drink. And when you're trying to get sober, the idea that you're going to go home to see your family or to go to a friend's house for dinner and you're going to face their that kind of situation, even though most alcoholics will buck up and say, it's my problem and you're right, I got to learn to do it anyway, I'm going to have to be around people who drink, so I'll tough it out. That's a lot of nonsense. They will have to, but they don't have to when they first start sobriety, and you don't have to be the genius that puts temptation in their way, especially if you're sick of the addiction and what it's done to their life. What's the matter with us sometimes? Why would we ever act that way? You would not, if someone had cancer, lung cancer, and you went to see them, assert your right to smoke and blow it in their face. Because it would be cruel, even though you have a right to do what you want. We minimize addiction and alcoholism by blaming the character of the person involved. And they do horrible things many times in the process of addiction. So we say, well, they're just a bad person, weak, they make bad choices, etc., right? And I'm done paying for their problems. I'm going to do what I want to. Oh, my goodness. look, you have a right to do whatever you want to, but at least here, again, in the clear light of day on a Sunday morning where we try to speak plain truth, I'm telling you, when you drink in front of an alcoholic and you know that they are struggling with their sobriety, right, that you know these things, what you are doing is choosing to assert your right to become a roadblock and a possibly stumbling block to someone who will likely die because they weren't up to the task of facing temptation that day. Please don't. If you have an alcoholic in your family, clear your cabinets and keep liquor and drugs out of your home. It's just that simple. If you don't have a problem with alcohol or drugs, then it should be no problem for you to clear the cabinet and go somewhere else if you want to have a drink. You have the right. You absolutely have the right to do what you want in your home, when you're at a restaurant, wherever it might be. But you are asked by Jesus Christ to live in this life gracefully, mindful of other people, and to be a help, not a hindrance. Okay, so sometimes I move from preaching into annoying, and I'm sorry. It's just, when I see these things, it hurts my heart because I also frequently am in on the last chapter of addictions as people die from them, and it is horrifying to see. I would do anything to be able to help folks along the way. In the Methodist Church, you might know that we use grape juice for communion. You might not know why. Mr. Welch, I believe his first name was James Welch, was a Methodist in the time when they were debating in our society whether they should make alcohol illegal. And he himself struggled with alcoholism and was sober and was determined to find a way to stop the fermentation process so that an alcoholic could come to worship service and receive Holy Communion without the taste of alcohol in their mouth, because he knew it was a trigger. That's why we use grape juice. That's where Welch came from. Did you know that history? That's why it is. We don't allow alcohol on the grounds of the church. A few times in my life, I found alcohol on the church in a variety of circumstances, and I'm never mean about it, but I get rid of it as fast as I can. Because if you're suffering from alcoholism, or if you're an addict, you have an absolute stone-cold right to show up at the place where we worship God with no more temptation than is absolutely necessary. You need to know it's always a safe place. You're not going to be around people that are high. You're not going to be around people that are drinking. In this place, it's sacrosanct. There is no alcohol. You can come here and safely abide in sobriety for the time that you're here. That's why the church operates the way that it does, in communion with grape juice and with its rules on the prohibition of alcohol. It isn't because we think no one should drink. That day passed, right? Experience taught us better than that. But it is because you should have a safe haven, and my goodness, your church should be a safe haven. I'm just asking that you think about making your homes a safe haven in similar circumstances. So there are phrases that arise out of the 12-step communities that people miss all the time. One of them is practicing sobriety. That sounds weird, doesn't it? You practice athletic competition. Somebody's practicing sobriety, either you're sober or not. Isn't that how we think? You have to practice sobriety because it's very, very hard. And it's very, very hard for these reasons. If you're an alcoholic or an addict and you have a really bad day and somebody says something to you that might have a little too much truth in it, and it shames you and makes you angry, and you get to feeling that way, then you know from long years of experience that you will feel better with the introduction of a chemical into your body. So now you're on the other side of the clarifying moment, and you're saying, I want to be sober, right? I can't do this anymore. But on that day, somebody shames you and points out your faults and humiliates you in public, and you begin to feel the way that you felt for a very long time. Add on to it all the damage that you've done in your addiction, which heightens that, and you only know for sure one way to make yourself feel better. What is that way? Alcohol or drugs. So it's frequent that somebody comes to the first big climax in their life, and they decide they're going to sober up, right? And they walk in sobriety for a season, for a month or 6 months or a year. And the family and friends say, oh, thank God they are cured, right? It's all over. It's nothing but glory in the future. And then they are absolutely obliterated when it happens again, right? When a person who has been sober for a good long time goes right back down the rabbit hole. Okay, well, if you knew it was coming, and it almost always is, then it wouldn't shatter you, because you really do have to practice. Here's another way to look at that same situation. That person made the decision to get sober, and they learned how to be sober up to a point, and when they stretched things as far as they can, and for whatever reason, they might have shortchanged one of the steps as they walked it with their sponsor. They might have just gotten into a horrible depression that nothing was going to back off at that time. All kinds of things conspire, and they fell off the wagon, right, which is a misnomer. They leapt off the wagon because they saw a pool full of beer. They relapsed. That's all that happened. Nothing worse than what happened before. Listen to me. Nothing worse than what happened before. And if you are in love with someone who relapses, you should have the attitude that as soon as they make the decision to get sober again, they'll be better at it than they were before. Because that's true. You practice sobriety. And the next time, the hope and the prayer is, if they made it a year the first time, they'll make it 2 years or maybe even stretch it to three. And the statistics get better and better and better the longer you're able to go. But they're likely to have another relapse. Shoot, they're likely to have a lot of relapses because it's a doggone hard thing. How do you deal with horrible days when you hate yourself and you don't trust anybody that you know? Some are rageaholics. That's pretty hard to change, right? Some people decide to hate other folks, right? Just really focus their hatred on them. That's an addictive thing too. Hard to learn to undo it. How is it that you medicate yourself and make yourself feel better when everything is horrible? I hope in a healthy way. But if you're a long-term alcoholic or addict, you only know one for sure thing to make yourself feel better that day. And it is a long process to learn, yeah, no. No, there are other ways, and I can do this. I go to a meeting, right? I can go to lots of meetings. I can talk to my sponsor. I can pray. I can call my pastor. It takes a long time to develop the skill of sobriety. Most people don't think of it that way. We couch all of this in moral terms. The alcoholic or the addict is bad because they do horrible things, and they do. But it doesn't mean they're bad. It means they're addicted, and they have to learn how to be sober, and they have to learn how to be sober for a very long time. The truth is, many people who taste sobriety for the first time in many years don't like what they taste. They have no skill at all in walking through the world sober and being accountable for their decisions and not being able to escape. And they willfully choose to dive right back into the addiction, and they're pretty much unsavable. Not much you can do. You hope that God will break through and help them. If your loved one relapses, all that's happened is they've learned how to be sober for however long they were, and your prayer and your attitude, I hope, will be, right, as soon as you're ready, right, when you come back to the point where you're sober, you're going to be better at it than you were before. That's the only loving attitude that you can have. They don't need any more condemnation, and they don't need to know that you're disappointed. They don't. They just need to know that you understand, wow, you did good this time, right? And if there's another time, and God, I hope there will be, I'll bet you go longer. In alcoholism, a fundamental rule is this. You can be sober for as long as you want. Let's say you make 20 years sobriety. If you take another drink, you don't begin the addictive process again. You start where you left off, and you fall off a cliff like nobody's business. So it takes practice to learn to walk a road. And the long-term benefits of long seasons of sobriety are most people with over 10 years of sobriety are quite likely, if they relapse, to gain another long, long season. It's up to us to stop the shaming and the demeaning and the anger and the blaming and all the stuff that is normal for us to do and just understand it's a process and the odds are stacked against them. So if they relapse, we pray and we try not to put temptation in their way. We try not to further humiliate them because that really drives addictive behavior anyway. And we wait. If they catch another wave of sobriety, we do everything we possibly can to walk alongside them faithfully and not be an impediment to that sobriety. Do you hear the different tone of the language when we talk about addictions this way? I know literally hundreds of alcoholics, and I'm not mad at any of them. I'm not mad that they're alcoholics. I hate the stuff they do sometimes. They're just human beings that are dealing with something I myself never dealt with unless you count smoking. And my nickname in the smokers community would have been Mr. Relapse, right? You know the joke, I quit 200 times. I was great at quitting. It was that whole second day thing. I'm not a bad human being. It took me a long time to figure out how to make it through a day without that crutch. A long time. And then when I did, it took me an even longer time to figure out how to make it through a bad day without that crutch. Okay. I can't ever tell when you're that kind of quiet, but I'm glad there are no tomatoes in the house. It is interesting to me and very powerful that truth, fundamental core God-created truth, is true regardless of the context. You always do better when you have the courage to turn the other cheek. Always. Seems weak, seems silly, seems whatever, but in experience, people who have learned to turn the other cheek or to absorb pain from other folks and still be gracious will witness to other people it's true, right? What Jesus taught actually works. It's not pie in the sky, swallow it down until you get released to heaven. It'll improve your life right now to do the things that Christ taught, to learn to forgive and to turn the other cheek and to try to be gracious. All those things are true. Whether you're a Christian or whether you're not, if you live that way, it brings its reward. And a core truth of our humanity, of how we get along and how we do better, is contained in the 12 steps. And in fact, it's the 12th step. And it's relatively simple. It's an odd thing. But the truth, when it comes to live in you, when you are open to it for whatever reason, humility being the main reason, the truth, once it gets inside of you, is powerful, but it's not at its full power. And it doesn't resource you or help you as fully as it possibly can until you pass it along. So a fundamental part for addicts and alcoholics of maintaining sobriety is they have to go to meetings, and at the meetings they have to tell their truth, the horrid, terrible, full of details that really make you sad truth. And they have to tell the truth of how they got sober. And then they have to, at some point, be willing to walk another person who's just learning to be sober through the 12 steps, explaining them and how they actually operate as they go. And when they do that, statistically again, the odds of their long-term sobriety go way up from somewhere around 1-3% to that 10-12% mark. There are a few who got sober and stayed sober and never sponsored anybody, but the vast majority of long-term sobriety people have sponsored somebody else, and that just means they have told their truth to another person in need, and then they have walked carefully with them through the progression of the steps to sobriety. It is interesting, isn't it? Christianity is exactly the same way. How many people do you know who intellectually know the faith inside and out, so the truth is at least contained in their head, but who show no sign whatsoever of responding to the call of the gospel? They aren't gracious, they aren't kind, they're judgmental, they're mean-spirited, they're all about themselves, and yet they can quote scripture day in and day out. A person in that condition has the truth inside of them, and they may share by telling other people what's wrong with them, but that's not sharing the gospel in the gospel way. On the other hand, how many people do you know in the church who are so good that it makes you wish that you could just be like them? You will note, if you think through those two lists in your life, that the people who are good openly and eagerly talk about not what you should do to change and be like them, but what God has done in their life. My sweet mother-in-law, and she was sweet a lot, Really, she was. Just hard as nails, but a really sweet and gracious woman. At her funeral, the pastor who performed the funeral said, I'd like to put a quote from Alice up on the wall. And I was thinking, what? Alice didn't use English even as well as I do. What kind of quote is he going to put up there? And the quote was this, trust God. Alice told every doggone person she ever saw who was in a horrendous state, and she saw lots of them, the same thing. You should trust God. Notice how different that is? That's not, wow, you got to come up to snuff. Let me tell you how I got to be like I am. That is, there's a power beyond yourself that can help you in this thing. You got to put some trust in God. Witnessing to what we have inside our lives helps cement the truth so that it begins to come out not just verbally, but in the way that we live and act towards other people. It's an irrefutable truth of modern Christianity that because we've turned the proclamation duty over to professional Christians like me, many lay people have ceased to say anything about their walk with God to their family or to their friends. They've swallowed their witness because they're afraid they'll get it wrong, or they might say something that might hurt somebody, or they're embarrassed and they don't want to be known as that kind of person, a variety of reasons. But the witness of the church, when it's left up to the preacher on Sunday morning, is a poor witness with almost no power contained in it. The gospel only really comes to life in a church community or in the world when people who attend church to be inspired then take seriously the truth, which is if you want your faith to be operative in your life, if you want to know that God is powerful, you got to be out there giving witness to the fact that God has been powerful in your life to the point that he has been. You got to tell people. You need to be telling your children and your grandchildren, right? In my life, the one constant has always been God. And when nobody else wanted anything to do with me, I could always go to God in prayer. And that has been the singular difference in my life. You have to share the faith that you have lived as earnestly as you can with other people for that faith to do its full work in you. And for you to have the satisfaction of knowing whatever you've done with your life professionally, at the very least, you scattered some seeds on the soil of humanity that may grow into beautiful blossoms in time. When we deal with alcoholism and addiction, our emotions and our judgmental side usually trump any considered opinion or sane practice. In this series, I wanted to point out the similarity between getting sober and getting sane if you don't have an addiction problem. I wanted to point out to you that the most effective program for the worst disease in humanity is 12 steps that bring you closer and closer to practicing in your life the things that Christ taught in his. And as we close now, I want you to know that when you're dealing with addicts and alcoholics in your life, your judgment should be that what they really need is to know that in your life, God has done things that you can scarcely believe, and he has that power for them. They do not need to know that you despise them, that you're angry, that you don't trust them, that you're through with them, that they're hopeless. They've got lots of evidence of those things. They need somebody in their life to keep them safe by not having temptation under their nose, and who will insist, no matter the circumstance, God is powerful enough to help you in your situation. If you will find it in yourself to trump your personal rights and your emotional judgments with the grace of the gospel proclaimed in your way in their lives, I promise you, you in your personal life will discover a living God more powerful than you would know if you haven't been witnessing. And I promise you this, you will have done that person no harm at all and put in their path at least a seed that someday might grow into a season of sobriety. You will have planted the possibility of a miracle in someone's life. And in the end, when we go to meet our Savior and we have to take a test on how we lived, don't all of us want to say, I lived all along telling others what you could do for them the way that you did it for me? I hope so. If you have difficulties in your family with addictions of any kind, please don't feel shame. If you want help, if you want to talk through it, call me, call anybody on staff. We have Al-Anon in our church. We have AA in our church. And we have NA in the community. And we're happy to point those things out to you. You may or may not know that every year on in January, I order 30 of the big book. That's the AA book with the 12 steps and Bill's story and all of those things. And there's never been a year in my ministry, except for this last, because very little foot traffic, that I haven't given all 30 away. There's no shame to have somebody that has this problem in your family, and we can help you at the very least figure out how to be sane in your own living and how to make choices that will help them rather than hurt them too. After all, really, that's part of the reason Christ put us together in the church, to be a help to one another. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we're mindful today, because of the things we've been talking about, of the people in our lives that have struggled with addiction. We remember watching them change course and seeming as if they were lost to us and to everyone else. As we remember them, we ask that you would bless them wherever they might be, that they might feel the touch and the power of your Holy Spirit. And we would ask also, Father, that in those impossible situations that we just don't understand, that you would bless us so that our better selves, our more faithful truth, can rise to the surface, and we can be in a place to plant your hope in their hearts, and that we can refrain from further humiliation or anger. Father, make us useful as much as possible. At the very least, help us not to be impediments. We love so many that we've lost in these ways, and we want in the future to do better because we know better. Guide us in those ways. It's in the name of Jesus Christ, who is salvation, that we pray. Amen. We're going to enjoy two more songs now as we kind of let the sermon soak in. So please rise and open your hearts to the power of worship.
You're still enough. Keep me within your love. Oh, my heart will sing your praise again. Oh, for your promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. For I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am child of God. no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. One more time. I'm no longer a slave to fear, yeah. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, yeah. I am a child of God.
You may be seated. I am Kelly Deditis, the Director of Care Ministries, and it is my privilege and an honor to represent you in many of our ministries, but one in particular, Drop in the Bucket. Today is Drop in the Bucket Sunday, and it is so good to finally be able to say, as you can see, the buckets surround the sanctuary. What we ask of you on Drop in the Bucket Sunday is that you would just reach into your pockets or your pocketbooks and just pull out the loose change that you have and then drop it in the bucket. We will then take those offerings and gather them together to share with someone in our community who has found themselves in an unusual circumstance, unable to make ends meet. By sharing a small amount from the blessings God has already given us, we are able to help those who are struggling. Drop in the Bucket is just one way that the Methodist Church is loving our community for Christ. Your generosity continues to meet the needs of families in our community. This month, we partnered with the District Attorney's Office to help a young single mother pay her rent. Feeling overwhelmed, stressed, and depressed by her current circumstances, court appearances as a victim of sexual assault, her small son being assessed for autism, she needed and then laid off because of COVID. While waiting for her unemployment benefits to process, she needed a little help and encouragement. A young mom and her son received the grace of Jesus Christ through the generosity of our church. We choose to make a big difference in individual lives as a way of honoring Christ for making such a big difference in ours. So if you would drop your loose change or small bills in the buckets as you leave today, for those joining us online, if you would like to be a part of our Drop in the Bucket ministry, consider adding just a small amount to your gifts and tithes and designate it to Drop in the Bucket. We make sure those funds are combined to make a big difference in somebody's life. Together, we are loving our community for Christ. Thank you. And now just a few announcements. Actually, there's quite a few announcements today, but we like to keep you updated and knowing what's going on. And as the season of Lent is upon us, we are getting ready to be very busy. We thank those who have joined us today, both in person and online. We are glad that you chose to worship with us, and we hope you enjoyed your experience this morning. If today is your first time with us and you would like to join our online community, please text the word LIVE to 559-657-6848. Those who are here in the sanctuary, if you would just text the word HERE to that same number, 559-657-6848. It helps us to know just how large our community is growing. I appreciate your cooperation with that. We all know that divorce is hard. We each experience it, whether it is in our own lives or the lives of someone we care for. We are here to help. Divorce care at the Methodist Church starts tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. for those separated or divorced. You can find practical and biblical help for healing from a marriage breakup. To register, visit divorcecare.org. Look for the Visalia United Methodist Church group or call the church office. On Ash Wednesday, that's this coming Wednesday, February 17th, at 5 p.m., we will have a service right here in our sanctuary. We hope that you will help start the Lenten season off right by joining us as a family. You can join us in person or online. This is the time of year we traditionally offer membership classes. We are currently planning our spring class, and if you are interested in learning what it means to join our church family, please contact Joanna by email or calling the church office. If you would like to join us in our missions and ministry by offering your support, we have several options for you. For online giving, just visit our website at visaliamethodist.org and click the Giving tab. For those who prefer to write a check, please remember to mail it to our P.O. Box 7360, Visalia, California, 93290. And for those who are here in the sanctuary, we have the traditional plates up front and also the iPads and drop boxes on your way out. We thank you in advance for your generosity. On Wednesday, February 24th, from 3 to 5, the Missions Committee will hold a drive-through enchilada dinner fundraiser, just $10 a plate. To reserve your meal, you can contact Pastora Corazon at, just email her at pastorcorazonvumc@gmail.com or text 559-339-3502. For those here on campus, tickets will be available between services today. Be sure to check out Pastor Steve's new weekly video blog, Happy Thoughts with Pastor Steve, where he will explore practical Christianity and discuss how we can live a life of faith in practical ways. You can find the weekly discussions on our website and YouTube channel. Next week begins the Forgiveness Series, a four-step process to forgiveness that will change your life and relationships. Join us live at 9:15. Invite your friends and family to watch with you or join us here. Be sure you like and follow us on Facebook. And now, if you will stand and join me in prayer. Oh, gracious and loving God, we continue to trust in you in all circumstances. We have worshiped you from our homes and in your courtyards, waiting patiently during this pandemic for your sanctuaries to be reopened. You have continued to love us, care for us, and protect us. For that and so many more blessings, we give you thanks. Today we celebrate together in your house, praying the way Jesus taught his disciples, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May you be filled with God's grace as you go in peace.